I'd like to review with you today just some of the more important issues dealing with a very popular operation known as the laparoscopic Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. We put that term laparoscopic on the front of that discussion because it's been the most popular way to perform this procedure over the last 10 years in our practice and almost 15 years in other parts of the world. But this kind of an operation is designed to help people lose significant weight. In fact, some studies have shown that in the long term, when we're talking out 14 to 15 years, the average patient will lose perhaps 50 to 60% of excess body weight and keep that weight off over those many years. Very importantly, too, these patients can experience a significant improvement in comorbid conditions, and by that we mean disease processes such as hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol, high triglycerides, heart failure, and severe obstructive sleep apnea, to mention a few of the more common problems. Just to review the anatomy of what's happening here, we've created a small stomach which will restrict how much a person can eat during a mealtime. We try to make that as small as 2 ounces per meal in the first phase of the operation, and then maybe never let a person eat more than 8 ounces in a meal long term as they adapt to it. The small bowel is connected to this little stomach in what's called an anastomosis. The term for that more specifically is the gastrojejunostomy. And in our practice, we hand sew this. We have it a fixed size. It's about the size of an index finger, for my index finger size. And it helps restrict the flow of food, but it does bring the food back down to the digestive enzyme stream, which is coming from the duodenum, where the pancreas and the bile from the liver flow in, and then they join together in a connection here again. This, if you look at it closely, is another connection or anastomosis. And this one is called the jejunojejunostomy because we're connecting jejunum to jejunum. And after that point, we have what's called a common limb. And in actual fact, this picture doesn't tell the true story. It's about 3/4 of the bowel length, or about 10 or more feet of small bowel from here to the large bowel. So by the time this food stream has joined with the enzyme stream, we have normal digestion. And so we rarely see patients get in trouble with too low of an albumin or too low of a nutritional level, as long as they eat reasonable and much smaller amounts of food for the rest of their lives and take their vitamins, they will do quite nicely. So what happens with a bypass is we now know that one of the more potent hunger stimulants, a hormone known as ghrelin, it's spelled G-H-R-E-L-I-N, is normally released in greater amounts when you fast or restrict caloric intake, unless you've had a gastric bypass, in which case the food stream goes around the stomach and the duodenum, and as a consequence, that hormone is no longer released, which is very nice for patients who are trying to lose weight to have that appetite stimulant be taken out of their system and allow them to have greater control of weight as a result. Some of the reasons that patients might have some fears about this is because it is major surgery. We are altering Mother Nature to try to get a gain that wasn't realized just through self-discipline alone. So there are some disadvantages to doing this surgery. The nice thing is that it's a very safe kind of operative procedure to perform when compared to other commonly performed major abdominal surgeries such as hysterectomies or total knee prostheses or any heart surgery. The risk of an adverse event or life-threatening complication is much, much lower. But it's not zero, and as a result, some people will have serious complications, and we have to take those into consideration. Other things that have to be addressed are the fact that you do have some degree of malabsorption, and you will have to take vitamin supplements, particularly vitamin B12, a common multivitamin in addition to that, and then calcium supplements. In any case, those numbers need to be measured, vitamin D levels, calcium levels, folate, B12, thiamine, every year to make sure everything is okay with vitamin levels. There is another issue called dumping syndrome. When you pour food straight from your esophagus through a little stomach and into small bowel, triggering the release of some hormones that normally wouldn't have been released because the food would have been processed going through the lower stomach and duodenum. In any case, these hormones can have a very active effect on your whole body, which then lead to what's called a dumping syndrome. The bowel quickens in its irritability, the peristaltic rate goes up, the body can release enzymes and hormones which will make your heart quicken, you might even perspire, you could have some abdominal rumbling and grumbling, and that's known as the dumping syndrome. It isn't diarrhea per se. That's an issue that doesn't necessarily go along with that syndrome, but can. It's precipitated by anybody who eats too much rich food too fast, especially after they have this new anatomy. So it's a matter of counseling and guidance to avoid that particular problem. This operation is a little bit difficult to put back to normal. You'd have to undo this connection and this one, reconnect stomach to itself and this small bowel to here. And we rarely would ever want to do that, but if that should come up, it is possible to be done. We keep these patients in the hospital for one night. In most cases, 95% of the time, they're discharged on the next postoperative day. We like to observe them perhaps longer than we would with a band because it's a more complex operation. Complications can occur with this operation as well that have to do with the mechanics of the surgical procedure itself. We can develop a tightening of this connection here known as a stricture, which might require dilation. Usually that's an outpatient procedure done with an endoscope, doesn't require another operation. But that sometimes shows up, perhaps one in every 20 patients or so. Early on in the surgery, we can see a little leakage of intestinal content through either a staple line or a suture line. That's one of the vagaries of doing this kind of surgery. We like to test our connections and our seals under the operative circumstances that we're in when we're in the operating room to make sure we're not leaving an obvious problem behind. And that reduces our leak rate, if we want to call it that, down to well less than 1%. Sometimes, because the bowel has been rearranged as it has, there can develop a bowel obstruction. And that can happen after any abdominal surgery. Scar tissue can form, the bowel can twist or kink. And so we have to be aware, as patients, you need to be aware that if you're having pain that doesn't seem right, and especially if it's severe, you need to be contacting me or one of my colleagues or whoever was your surgeon right away to be sure that isn't a serious issue. We think that the mortality rate on this operation in our practice is better than what is reported nationally. Our statistics suggest it's about a 0.1% mortality at 30 days, which means 1 in 1,000 patients would be at risk of death. Nationally, it's probably 0.2% or 2 out of 1,000. In any case, if we can get to patients should they have leaks or if they develop a blood clot early on in their recovery, we will have a better chance of rescuing them and preventing this from becoming something serious. If you don't take your vitamins, you run the risk of developing neuropathy, which means that either the brain or the peripheral nervous system doesn't work properly. You can see this with vitamin B12 deficiency, with acute thiamine deficiency. So this has to be safeguarded in terms of taking your vitamins daily in order to prevent these problems. And if you're having trouble ingesting your vitamins, that you get immediately in contact with your physician who did your surgery. I think that pretty much wraps up the good things and the bad things about this operation. Overall, I think the message should be that it's a very healthy, wonderful opportunity to help us deal with a problem that heretofore hasn't had a real great solution. And you'll be hearing more about some other options which also have admirable track records, and so I'll defer to my colleagues to discuss that as we continue with this little lesson.